Tonight we are very fond of English at Hunter College and the Graduate Center of the City University of New York. She's the author of several books of poetry, most recently Illiterate Heart, published by Northwestern. And she's also a winner of the 2002 Penn Open Book Award. Her memoir, Fault Lines, was one of Publisher Weekly's best books of 1993, and her novel, Nampali Road, was a 1991 Voice Literary Supplement, Editor's Choice. Please welcome Professor Poet Meena Alexander.
Do we need this?
Fine. We need that too.
Oh goodness, yes, I'm sort of technologically a bit challenged as usual. I'm delighted to be here and to read in the company of John Yao. I'm going to read today a few poems from a book called Raw Silk, which will come out in July. And the first poem, I'm just calculating the minutes on this wonderful clock, so 5, 10, 15, 20, all right, I get an idea. The first poem I'm going to read is called Hungriest Heart, and it's a poem where I address my heart. Hungriest heart, where are you now? Wrapped in blue with starched white blouse, hair tucked into braids so tight, sparrows sought you out. All your girl's equipage, sack of eggs, pouch of blood knotted into skin. You are fleeing what was meant to be real, a house without wheels, the bone's high arc without let or forgiveness. Why call it home, O cuckoo's cradle? I'm going to move on to a set of poems that I wrote after a visit to Italy. And the first poem is called Porta Santa. And it's set partly in Florence, partly in Rome. Porta Santa. You bought rolls of bread so hot, they might have been stones from my childhood. I followed you, twisted my ankle, fainted an instant, losing body. Then, someone whose hair glows in the dark led me to a grove of olive trees. I turned back to the Arno. I saw the blue Giotto saw. I wept at stones that stored so much light. So where are you now? In the transparent phone booth in Fiumicino Airport, in the crush of those forced to draw metal carts, piled with open cartons, precious scraps of clothing, on the runway beside darkened palms, jets hover, wings spilling sparks. And the door you led me through, Porta Santa, beside the room where I could not sleep, beside the street named for the serpents, beside the blind beggar covered in sackcloth, vieni, vieni chi, terrible guide, what would Dante have made of you? Door of water, door of earth, mirror of gold I stepped through, hearing the voices of pilgrims cry, who will melt swords down, fill courtyards with grain. My soul, naked, unashamed, watching from a distance, the body, old sari, washed with blue soap, folded with care, set on a stone Giotto painted beside a laughing shepherd boy. The next poem is called Roman Ground, and it's part of the same cycle of poems. By the Roman Forum, speckled wildflowers, olive trees roped by wind, fragments of granite before the flood. In high school, we used to leap over the barrier till one night I saw a man. You pointed to a high window in a building of the Campidoglio, threatening to leap. "See me," he cried, as the police scurried around with blankets. Who was he? A government clerk? A bus driver? A silhouette stuck at a window's ledge? He cured me from jumping into the Temple of Saturn. It was built by Romans in a season of distress. They had plagues, fires, famines, floods. The ordinary rotted down, the sacred raised florets of stone into the sun. In your country, you have floods, no? I shut my eyes, saw stacks of rosewood floating in the courtyard, stick-thin shacks swirling in red water. Patiravil ati patie, my father's father, lips bruised with beetle each midnight, crying himself home. The house of God walls tilted under skies where the river of heaven pours. A silence rose between us. Cicadas bristled in the olive leaves. Pigeons clustered on warm stone. Lua, lua Saturni, I heard you murmur. To loosen, grow lustrous, liberate. I long to touch your lips, nostrils, eyes. Sharp and hard, that need, forcing me to front the cornices of ruin. A sky creased with pink, a ledge where a man stood crying, "Look, look at me," for no one had ever seen him in his life before. We stood on the littered earth, struck by sun into wheels of flame. When I turned to you, your hair was smoldering. There were tears in your eyes. The wind was chill, and I moved a little closer. Then the stones beneath and the stones around grew steady in raw Roman ground. I'll read two more poems written set in Italy, but written at a slightly later time. And the first one is called Lago di Como. I search for a stone to sit on, so I can look down into a valley and write lines about a house I enter to find you. I try to keep walking, but after the storm, branches flood the path, make me squint and crouch. What I cannot peer through is memory. A girl in a rose bush, thighs stuck with petals, scratch marks scarcely visible. What floats into view is a door I cannot go through. But I want to go on and on until I reach you. At the threshold of the house, I imagine fish hooks tethered to sunlight, an old shirt hanging on a line. It is after your bath. Your hair is wet. You're in front of an oval mirror rimmed in silver. You are combing your hair. Oh, for an afternoon, eyes wide open, filled with the moisture of love. And the next poem is very, very short. It's called Door, just three lines. By your door, a sweet olive tree, a hole in its trunk, swarm of bees in the lap of heaven. I will read another very short poem, also written in Italy. It's called Field in Summer. I had a simple childhood, a mother and father to take care of me, no war at my doorstep. Stones sang canticles in my mouth as darkness rose. Love, love, where are they gone? Father, mother, ink dark stars, singing stones. I'm going to read a different kind of poem. I'm not sure if it's a different kind of poem, maybe a different mood. I'm going to really turn to India. On September 11th, 2002, and I remember a while back, I read poems from September 11th, 2001 here, but on September 11th, 2002, I was in India, and I was visiting the relief camps in Gujarat for the Muslim survivors of some terrible ethnic violence that had occurred there. And I was with a very good friend of mine, Swati Joshi, who was collecting eyewitness testimony for a group called the People's Union for Democratic Rights. And, you know, I was haunted, in fact, tormented by the fact that this violence had occurred in Gandhi's hometown. And my grandparents were Gandhians, and I'd been raised in this, you know, this idea of nonviolence. And I wrote a cycle of poems after my visit, and they will be in the new book, Raw Silk, but they were first published as a small pamphlet at Oxford, or in Oxford University, at the South Asian Forum. And I've never really read them as a whole, you know, read them out. So I will take the occasion and just read these poems. It's a cycle of poems, and I will try and end, you know, time. My first poem is called Red Bird. A red bird shoots through a cloud of leaves. The sky is filled with sparks. I sit eating water chestnuts. These are the best years of your life. Whose voice is that? The nuts are pale as running milk, their lids bruised green. A boy with brown eyes wields a knife, sets it all at my knee. Madam, these panifal are for you. Eat, please. I sit in the light of a boy's eyes, chewing water chestnuts. The shed where they raped the women is far away. Far away the flung bones, piled in the shape of a cross. This is my country. I was born by the Ganga, close by as a bird flies. The next poem is called Amrita, and it evokes Amrita Shergill, the famous Indian painter who lived in Paris for some of her life. But this is when she's returned to India, and it's in her voice. Amrita, part one. I was dressed in a fine muslin sari over which I wore a fur coat. Behind me, an old man with camera. Picture perfect, nothing cost a shadow. Part two. My father, Umrao Singh, fasted for 15 days, took a photo of himself in skimpy loincloth, waist delicate as a heron's neck. Later, my nephew played with light, set us edge to edge. In time's transparency, father and I shone bright. Part 3. Nights, I get no rest. A rubber ball bounces off Parisian tapestries, lands in my fur coat, splashes me. Hold me, a child cries. My name is Yunus. Can you hear me, Yunus? He stands there half naked, his green shirt torn, flapping, his belly and ribs smoking. He skips away. I see his bottom burst like a raw fruit with the flames they tossed him in. I put out my arms to touch him, but father's tripod trips me up. Part 4. I want to whisper, I'm Amrita, sweet as burnt gold in the dargah of Wali Gujarati. Here are my paints, my brushes bright as bone. Come to me. The next poem is called Naroda Patia, and it evokes an atrocity that occurred, which is, it'll be there in the poem. Dark eyes, the color of burnt almonds, face slashed, lower down where her belly shone a wet gash. Three armed men, out they plucked a tiny heart beating with her own. No cries were heard in the city. Even the sparrows by the temple gate swallowed their song. The next poem evokes a famous poet of Gujarat, a Muslim poet whose name was Wali Gujarati. And in the season of this extremity, mobs destroyed his tomb and they paved a road over it. And my friend Swati and I went early one morning and couldn't find the tomb, and there was just this polished road. Searching for a tomb over which they paved a road. Where is the tomb of Wali Gujarati? Gold leaf scatters in the wind. His poems cry out for feet, hands, throat, for genitals and mouth. Surat has forgotten him. He sang her praises to the moon. And now, where is my skin, my bones? I am the poet of a city in ruins, burnt by the sun, bound to the moon. The reeds by the river are lashed to swords. My dust is in the mouth of the bloodied rose. I'm going to move on to one or two poems in which I directly address Gandhi, Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi. And the first one is called Slow Dance. I mean, Gandhi, as you know, is dead, literally dead, but he should be also alive, right, for us. So I was addressing him. And the first poem is called Slow Dancing. I was kind of talking to him, right? So, oops. Dear Mr. Gandhi, please say something about the carnage in your home state. How did you feel when they shut the gates of Sabarmati Ashram that February night and the wounded clung outside? What has happened to Ahimsa? Is it just for the birds and the bees? What lips, what soul swarmed across the river? Is it hot on the other side? Oh, so many questions, sir, I cannot help myself. I cannot shut my mouth. It's hard to hear you. Birds peck at sounds, maggots gnaw, since even syllables have skin. The kingdom of heaven is tiny as a mustard seed, and you have crawled therein. Mist pours from mango trees, the moon soars in a sea of blood. I see you at the rim of heaven, grown older still, bewildered, stooped, dhoti flecked with drops of mud, face seared by a moon that has nothing except its own inhuman glow, the archipelago of light afloat in monsoon air, where souls frail as pinpricks go. Dear Mr. Gandhi, please talk to me now. I am slow dancing in the dark with the untimely dead, and that is all I know. Next poem is called Bengali Market. And some of you may know Bengali Market in Delhi, where you can get the most wonderful sweets, but also fruit. And I had gone to Bengali Market in December, and I saw a very dear friend of mine, Ramu Gandhi, sitting, who's actually Gandhi's grandson, sitting in one of these putt-putt-putt three-wheelers, you know, these little auto rickshaws. So, this is the poem. It's again addressing the grandfather, Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi. It's called Bengali Market. Dear Mr. Gandhi, it was cold the day the masjid was torn down stone by stone, colder still at the heart of Delhi. 10 years later, entering Bengali Market, I saw a street filled with bicycles, girls with rushing hair, boys in bright caps. I heard a voice cry, "Can you describe this?" It sounded like a voice from a city crusted with snow to the far north of the Asian continent. I saw him then, your grandson, in a rusty three-wheeler, wrapped up in what wools he could muster. Behind him in red letters, a sign, Dr. Gandhi's Clinic. "So," he said, embracing me, "you've come back." Then pointing to the clinic, "It's not that I'm sick. That gentleman gets my mail and I his. That is why I'm perched in this contraption. I cannot stay long. It is Eid ul-Fitr. I must greet friends in old Delhi, wish them well." Later, he sought me out in dreams, in a high kitchen, in sharp sunlight, dressed in a khadi kurta, baggy jeans. He touched my throat in greeting. "Listen, my sweet, for half of each year, after the carriage was set on fire, after the Gujarat killings, I disappear into darkness. In our country, there are 2 million dead and more for whom no rights were said. No land on earth can bear this. Rivers are crisscrossed with blood. All day I hear the scissor bird cry, cut, 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 cut. It is the bird Kalidasa heard as he stood singing of buried love. Now our boys and girls take flight on rusty bicycles. Will we be cured?" I cried. And he, "We have no tryst with destiny. My hands, like yours, are stained with fruit of the pomegranate. Please don't ask for my address. I'm in and out of Bengali Market." The last poem that I will read you concludes the cycle, and it is called Gandhi's Bicycle, My Muse Comes to Me. Gandhi actually did have a bicycle. "I come to you with a jute bag filled with bits of cloth marked with the colors of heaven. I have meditated long and hard on the poems you read at the academy. In Ancestors, you have grandparents, male and female, on wheels, cycling around ground zero. Bipedality is no longer possible. The earth is cut from underfoot. Have you seen the photo of Gandhi on his bicycle in South Africa? He tried to walk the earth, the British made fun of him, also for the way he dressed. Catastrophe drove you to a grandmother in a sari on a bicycle, furiously pedaling where the towers once stood. Also a grandfather, I presume, with briefcase marked lyric. But don't lose sight of epic. That very month, that very day, September 11th, in 1893, Swami Vivekananda stood in Chicago, a dark rose on its stalk. Chicago is in the Midwest, of course. Sisters and brothers of America, he began, and there was thunderous applause. How many would dare say that now? But we need to say that, you and I, even in the teeth of war. Come closer now. Do you hear the still, sad music of children killed in Godhra and Naroda Patia? Come closer to this table, cut from a tamarind tree in my grandfather's garden. Each poet needs a table to lay her wares on, don't you agree? You can write your poems here, so they gather the sour, sweet light of eternity. One last thing. Please don't keep writing letters to Gandhiji. He has gone through so much already. Sometimes I dream he's hidden in a cupboard with three doors, where he's also stashed his bicycle. Thank you very much. Whoops. Oh, I'm trailing this item, right? This is...
Thank you.
And now I'm privileged to introduce our next distinguished poet, John Yao, who is author of more than 2,000 books of poetry, fiction, and criticism. His most recent books of poetry included Borrowed Love Poems, published by Penguin, and My Heart is That Eternal Rose Tattoo by the Black Sparrow Press. The Passionate Spectators, a book of essays on poetry and art, will be published by the University of Michigan Press. His next book of poems, which is not yet titled, will be published by Penguin in 2006. He also recently joined the academic rank and was appointed Assistant Professor of Critical Studies at Mason Groves School of the Arts at Rutgers University. Please welcome Professor Poet John Yao.
I guess I've read mostly poems from the last couple of years. I fall into different groups, so I'll try to divide them up. And this is a poem for Tom Gunn, the English poet who died recently. For Tom Gunn, it was a photograph of you, handsome, lean, comfortable in your motorcycle jacket, that made me read the poems below over and over again, as if by reading them repeatedly, some clue as to how to become a poet would surface. That you could have played a supporting role in The Wild One, and been Marlon Brando's sidekick, the symmetrical opposite of Lee Marvin. Didn't your first book come out in 1954, the same year as this repeatedly banned film? Made me think that I too could become a poet. What did I know? I was naive, not well read, and practically scared of my own shadow. Alone with all the lights out, watching TV, my parents thankfully already asleep, I saw Gary Snyder in his white judo outfit bicycling in Kyoto, Frank O'Hara in his dark suit and thin tie, reading his poems, talking on the phone, smoking. It must have been when I was 15. Your photograph also helped give me confidence that anyone, even me, could become a poet. It was a necessary delusion, I realize, but I didn't have much more than that then. Unlike you, I was born in America. This is a poem I wrote shortly after my daughter was born, and it's in her voice. She's talking to me, of course, when she's 4 months old. Conversation after midnight. The civilization of green ants met last week or month. Your sense of time, a concept I don't yet understand, and besides, I wasn't there. And they elected me to come here, even though me was still not me, or even an I. An unarticulated murmur, maybe that, at best some dust of unlikely possibility. I was nevertheless elected to be among you, to arrive and to periodically whimper, howl, stir, scream, cry in a black spring night gone sour with images of the moon. Oh, oarless alabaster boat, oh, pearly O, sitting high above the savannah. So many poets still call on us, if it's the next door neighbor. A ubiquitous presence signifying the right proportion of magic and tragedy when they want to let everyone know how divine they've become in the interim, kissed by capital G, you might say. But I need not tell you that you are hardly divine. A lump is more like it if it is what you are. My name is Cerise Zara Ashheim Yao. I'm your daughter. I've been here a little over a month, crying, shitting, eating, sleeping, restless. As I extend my arms and kick my feet, and I can see that you're perplexed by what I'm trying to tell you through the infant you hold in your hands, the one you think of as your daughter, which she is. But I, too, am your daughter, I, who am an I, you, me, two, three, the one elected by the green ants, their leader whispered something. Was I to repeat it word for word, as if such repetition is accurate, a higher form of mimesis than trompe l'oeil? Something I've forgotten during the during and enduring from the to the, here and there not yet having hardwired their coordinates within the celestial tumult, something in words about and through them perhaps I can't remember, which is why no amount of beseeching is going to yield anything more from me than I'm the poem. Yes, I'm the one you want to write or be written by, you boob, or should I say boob is sanctimonious. I'm the poem you need to listen to and for, the one that isn't one but one of the ones who might step out from the flickering skyline of transparent shadows and say to you years from now, hey, old farting sag face, dim bulb in a dark and gloomy night, why did you spend years shitting all that goop on the pristine white page after white page? And you will smile, knowing I know the answer, knew it before here became the time-space continuum I inhabit. But this is a conversation that will unfold at and in another time. Right now, being right now, I'm hungry. So go get me something warm to drink, will you, bud? And hey, mister, whoever you are, you better quit calling me Pippalotti Poopsalot, Starvin' Marvin, Crusty Punkin' and Kid. I got a name, why don't you use it? And this is in that group. Here we go. It's called Two Sonnets. Said that his brother was an unfortunate mistake. Said that the fortune teller was beyond reproach. Said that the other lived in a fantasy world. Said that he was born with evil leaking from every pore. Said that the other was always lying. Said that he had to decide if they were leaving for good. said that he still hadn't repaid them for all the time they spent on feeding and clothing him, said that just before dying the other realized how wrong she had been about him, said that he did not know anything about suffering, said that he had no business talking about his brother, said that he was intellectually superior to his brother, said that he had systematically taken away all of their pleasure. Two. They sent each other sentimental poems. They told him stories that were haunted by their dead selves. They did not bless him when he entered his bed. It was, they told him, a coffin that would eventually fit him. They mourned their childhood whenever the opportunity arose, which was often. They got angry when he pummeled a stuffed rabbit. They said it was his fault that he had a brother. They told him his sorrow was self-inflicted. They repeatedly said that they never lied or exaggerated. They slept in a trench full of rain and believed until the day they died that something more terrible was imminent. They laughed when he told them that he was running away. This is the last from this kind of group that I brought along. It's called Diaspora. My father shifted in his chair and turned the page. He was reading the diary of a cavalry officer who admired his adversaries. Upside down, the walk looked like a flying saucer, so I carefully surrounded it with rows of plastic Indians and Cuban guerrillas dressed like American Marines. The only problem was that none of them had beards. It was only the 50s, but already I was on the wrong side. She seldom told me who was speaking, only that she was being spoken to. History is fraught with those who failed to heed the music wafting right under their noses. Perhaps we will know where time went once we get there. All day the spaceship sat on the great plains of the dining room table my parents carried with them whenever they moved, rooming house until she saw another tenant pissing in the kitchen sink, basement apartment with steam pipes, two-room storefront with glass bricks between living room and sidewalk, sixth-floor walk-up, first-floor apartment, two-family house. The couple who lived in the other half owned the house in a Chinese restaurant a few blocks away. House with garage and backyard on a dead-end street. The American dream is increasing your ability to be in debt. When they finally could afford to owe $20,000, they were proud of what they had accomplished. 35 years later, the dream nearly over, I cover the table's worn surface with a clean tablecloth, check to make sure there's more than enough food in the refrigerator and that the beer is getting cold. I walk out to the car and wait to drive my father and brother to the building where she's lying in her coffin, her eyes closed at last. Even though the snow has started to melt and the icicles above the garage door are dripping, it's a languorous morning. I want to tell her that they left long ago, that their mission was fulfilled. So I'll change directions. This is a group of poems called Andalusia that I wrote. I was asked by a Japanese artist who lives in Germany named Laiko Ikemura to possibly collaborate with her. I'm not sure what she meant, but then after a while I wrote these poems and sent it to her. So I guess it'll happen because she likes them. But anyway, Andalusia, and they were written, I was kind of trying to do research on Arab women, Muslim women living in Spain who wrote, who their names were never written down, and I had found references to their work, which I tried to imitate and then realized I had to make up my own. And this is between the 9th and 12th century. Andalusia. And I was also doing research or reading about Persian miniatures, so it all gets mixed up. Andalusia, and there's eight, I think. Time quietly peers in each window, but only the children find it funny. The second necklace we wear is the horizon circling our waists and throats as the flowers splash the sky with twilight and constellations map out the mishaps settling above the city. Abracadabras and horoscopes are impatient with sleep and calligraphy. Grant me a sheet of paper that will not turn to ash, and this hand will write down afternoon's clouds while you are hidden in my eyes. It is enough, the sheet of paper where I've hidden you in these days of smoke and candle flames. Grant me time to pause and inquire of the clouds if they have concealed you in their tears behind a red sky in which the moon briefly flies. Grant me a sheet of paper that we might live near the heat we once made when our hands pelted the sky with ink and paint. Margins of thought curled like eyelashes. Ask them if they remember us now that our names are forgotten. 2. Rooftop roosters announce a new regime. Even at night and guided by the moon, the sky can never find a cloud that fits. But for the painter, each cloud is snug. Still, it is the sheet of paper that I want beside the metallic inks keeping these lovers safe in the small garden where even the birds have stopped to look at their reflections. 3. Are clouds not sketches for a sculpture that can never emerge from stone? The neck of a cat visits you at night. Are the stars still spies loyal to no one? All that is left are these jackals wandering across a glittering field. Our shadows have floated into the sky, leaving our other shadows behind. No need to inquire where or how. Someday you too may need this garden. 4. Was it a madman who claimed there's no reason to remember these stones descending from an oscillating sky? Are you here to pick clean these emerald, amethyst, pearl, and topaz leaves and branches? By the gold border, white jasmine shed their petals, and the carnelian's red shadow awaits a mortar and pestle. 1,000 miles of clouds to climb the tower. We will leave no footprints in the dust, nor ever again smooth the swaying grass. Not even particles of our names will be sifted from this storm of lines. Andalusia 5, postcards. Mother of pearl cloud, clads clump and clawed. Quillons and spandrels, curlicues and spikes. Irregular medallion, lustrous heron. Emerald tears sparkle in skies, mortar and pestle. 6. Above, against, below, beside, near and around. Outside, buttressed by imaginary flowers. Within a storm of letters, echoing arches. Beneath a serpentine cloud dipped in ink. Near a circle of lilies, each steep petal. Beside twin strands of hexagonal tears. Above a shadow, tracing its shadows. 7. Story of flanking rosettes, palmettes, and petals. Stories of alloys and allies, metal mouthpieces and fleshy mouths. Story of caparisoned elephants imprisoned in silk. Story of sky's pillared pavilion in an address unraveled by butterflies. Story of apricot, lilac, pistachio, and blue cobalt. Story of flowers that do not grow on earth and must be turned in the light to be seen. Story about beginning before a story begins and becomes a story about beginning. And this is the last one in the series. I offer no proof that we were here in sky's tent beneath stars' arrows. Written in invisible ink on smoke rising above the night we were together. I offer no proof that we were ever here, folded together in a cloud's folds, now that it is an exquisite picture that anyone can visit. So this is a It's a poem called Even Now, in which I'm imagining somebody's retiring from something, but I'm not sure what he's retiring from and if he's seen or not. Even now, I cannot express the many sylvan empires of gratitude I contain, nor adequately thank you all enough. But I hope that even after I offer these last few words, these lamentable surrogates, these inadequate representations, these ruthless domiciles, that you will still find it possible to pardon me, who is after all just a sack of small potatoes, for not instantly sitting down with the others made of stone. But isn't it time to mention that the dust-filled manuals that are a true sign of our steadfast frugality should serve as sufficient warning to the vast sea of identical vagrants threatening to turn our charming way of life into a churning tapestry others can pick through, squandering whatever inflamed kernels they might sift from the unraveling sand, knowing full well their chances at winning the lottery diminishes with each new breath. Might not someone among us one day, many detours hence, choose to pause and remember that for many carefully annotated chapters now, we have prevailed against each caucus of newly arrived waves because, as uninvited dinner guests, our lantern-jawed ancestors, however pitiable they might appear to us from this end of the telescope, were able to annex an untamed vestibule of rapid growth and mounting interest rates without becoming vacillating vassals or, in more familiar parlance, lowbrow weasels who count their Roman numerals but not their intact crustaceans. True, the wind has a new objective now, and the movie version is faded into star-pierced wallpaper. But what flashlight of propaganda did you believe would succeed when you left the kennels open and let dinner be served late to packs of rogue ogres who have remained disappointed over the reapportionment plan? Each lot neat as a tie rack in a mortician's closet, as mandated by the sacred vegetables we consult during sanctioned emergencies, such as the one that befell the outer compost heaps during our infatuation with pointed structures. What exactly marked the first swirling exit that remembered us? And what will our whistling do now? Isn't it time that we revisit the dribbling string of beads that leaves us exposed to the cement sky rumbling toward this moment? No pageant, no matter how well planned, can steep us in the minutiae necessary to press across the tundra, but soon we'll be ensconced in our government-issue kayaks and straw kilts, foolhardy as snakes entering a volcano. Although much has to be done, we should remain undaunted by the distractions Don dumps outside the dump, and the train conductors begin saluting the shadows they think are our president, who's busy petting his stolen dog. Such is the burden and joy of our legacy that we should not let it slip into a lobby while those of us who can still choke on our bread and wine and nuts have yet to do so. I guess that was Ronald Reagan's farewell speech. Now that I think about it, I knew there's a reason I rescued it from its place. Okay, speaking of Ronald Reagan, this is a movie called Monogram Studios. I think I brought two. Yes. Monogram Studios was like the lowest film studio, kind of. They were called Poverty Row Studios. They would always have groups of people write their film scripts. And they sort of turned them out fast to be the B on a double feature in the 40s and 50s. So I decided to kind of play around with all the plots that I could remember and see how long I could stretch them out. Monogram Studios. After a solid income earner recounts his dream to a phony magician he meets on a 3-star bus, he steals a gun in a desperate attempt to distract himself from suspecting that his new wife is secretly the eldest daughter of a retired Roman general who is rumored to have driven his first two wives insane. before a woman settles on a blind carpenter to bury her husband behind the patio overlooking a hospital for recovering counterfeiters, she decides to impersonate a distraught nurse by climbing onto the windswept, bird-infested ledge of a condemned skyscraper. When a novelist's tarnished assistant is seduced by a handsome patsy, recovering from an unfortunate lapse that occurred during hypnosis, a stylishly dressed thief convinces herself that she's inadvertently learned what the members of a crime magazine coven have up their sleeves. Mistaking the huge green star mounted on the prison tower for a sign, the three newly arrived visitors from outer space decide that it would be best if they make bronze impressions of their footprints and mail them to their Hittite counterparts. The retired neophyte explains that the fabulous will become much less nebulous after the yearly drought passes, but a few miles away on the same paved road, there are many splendid views of goatskin tents, plastic surgeons, and dried meat. Set in the massive lobby of a burning public building, which the audience realizes is an inaccurate rendition, foreign mice and bowlers and tuxedos devise an elaborate hoax, which requires that one of them is reincarnated while the others stare on in disbelief. I know you all saw that movie, you just don't want to admit it. And this is Monogram Studios 2. Roped centaurs and their seashore chaperones snore in the dumpster behind the motel. A gabber and gabardine thaws in the garage. In the kitchen, polishing silverware, especially the ceremonial forks, their extravagantly elongated tines, the chauffeur, scarred boots, sweaty epaulets, and scrap heap collar, his unmistakable silhouette worming its way across the ceiling. Among the sprockets turning slowly beneath the infamous Victorian calendar, its carefully rendered drawings of nail pairings, the audience immediately recognizes that, while relatively likable, a rebellious but not necessarily youthful lycanthrope repeatedly forgets to apply cosmetics to the latest stool pigeon to defect from the catacombs running beneath the hospice gas station in Caravanserai before happily defecating in his richly ornamented meal pouch. One spawned, the other spurned. And between these two fortresses, the farmers tilted their cold brows toward the ashen sun. Enduring another humdrum shift until he's unexpectedly inspired to deliver a necklace of crushed black orchids to the suspicious wife of a superstitious embalmer, but his best friend who moonlights as a rickshaw repairman is mistaken for a well-preserved denizen of Pompeii and accidentally released like a jar of flesh-colored dust into the path of an oncoming marchioness. Once the implant has been inserted into a part of the brain the host seldom visits, the operating team opens the nursery school's attic window and vanishes into the warm suburban air. Curlicues of smoke appear in the mirror, just as a three-legged lawyer out to prove something stops and points to the senator's barn, its calm, stable facade, evening arrives with its bright red clots. My mother let me watch too much television. Actually, I just used to skip school and watch television. So I have, I think, four more poems to read. Or three, or two. This is called Sotto Voce. Part of the process of writing this poem was to choose lines from books that were in the room where I write and just put them into the poem and see what would happen and see how they would suggest something. Sotto voce, it's raining in New York, raining and raining. The sky is full of confetti, but it is not confetti. In a letter dated April 3rd, 1870, Mallarmé wrote, I don't know which of my internal climates I should explore in order to find you and meet you. The aurochs and orangutans are restless, far-flung crinoline stump patter. For a week, now, not a single cockroach has been spotted. Conform, confound, confront, congratulate. I'm not perturbed by your pertinacity. In the Clara story, Cleopatra clenches a clerk. The spider moves to the ceiling. She was born in a 40-room house in Shanghai and died in a 6-room house in Burlington, Mass., not far from the mall. Monks are not allowed to talk at meals nor think of food. John Wilkes Booth was the son of Junius Brutus Booth. There's a statue of John's brother Edwin in Gramercy Park. Let us consider some theories explaining reincarnation via hypnosis. In August 1914, as the world was crumbling, Kandinsky traveled from Munich to Switzerland to Russia. An out-of-the-body experience may have its roots in childhood trauma. The Moroccan cab driver tells me that it's no longer possible to leave Manhattan. All the bridges are closed on the further notice, and the subways are finally undergoing repair. Is it important that my socks don't match? On a day when a famous magician is unable to return from the place he sent himself, a small errand, he told the audience. I will only be a minute becomes a headline that a man in a bright blue suit with oversized lapels would rather forget as he quaffs more coffee from a flawless pink porcelain cup he found in a flea market run by Russian emigres. I've eaten ostrich, muskrat, and small pets. When he was 16, his mother asked him to move out as she thought his room would be put to better use if a servant slept in it. The I, Wittgenstein wrote, is not an object. I objectively confront every object, but not the I. Years after, he walked through grizzly bear country alone, and shortly after he told his hostess it had been a wonderful evening, he put a gun to his head and pulled the trigger. The Empress of Fiji once asked me for directions to a hotel known for its international clientele, but I didn't know that Fiji has no empress. The fountain is gray only when the temperature goes below freezing. The parrot next door has started speaking Spanish. The toy repairman wants to name his children after the capitals of states that end in A. I always keep 12 cans of meatballs in the front closet. The kangaroo is tired of practicing for his upcoming match. A stack of postcards from the Bonn train station. I was sent because I had a clean slate and was well versed in the art of handling a fork and a steam shovel. It's quite possible that Manchuria in the initial post-glacial period was covered by woods. The last time we spoke, he told me he had 5 jobs. Luggage handler, supermarket shelver, part owner of a baseball memorabilia store, taxi driver, and clerk. Hart Crane jumped off the bow of the Orizaba. The vampire unbuckled his shoes and stretched out on a pile of newspapers that had been delivered to the wrong address. My uncle was a plumber who had no knack for the job. On a shelf in the bedroom are 17 mice which run on batteries. If in your dream you encounter a dunghill, money will arrive through the most unexpected sources. On the landing in the back hall, I see that I live on the 33rd floor of an 8-story building. My parents lie side by side in an unmarked grave at the bottom of a hill in a suburban cemetery, surrounded by a chain-link fence. I've had many nicknames and like none of them. A passion for idealized reality and attractive surfaces, rendered with excessive, almost fanatical precision, are common features of the period. All morning, countless throngs of hard and sparkling elements with rounded contours descend and dissolve. Stamps from Italy and Borneo. The emperor has dispatched the orchestra director on a fast horse to find the Poe, who sprawled across a table in a local wine shop. Outside, the dogs have started barking, though no one predicted this would happen. I'm nearly 53, my daughter is not yet 2. Samuel Rosenstock is better known as Tristan Tzara. At the age of 40, he had a revelation and decided that he should be president. An instrument that measures electrical potentials on the scalp and generates a record of the brain's electrical activity. Is it a mere accident that the jawbone of a skeleton was chosen to represent such an important mathematical symbol? Talon, talus, tamale, tamarack, tamarind. One of Gurdjieff's most devoted students was Olga Ivanovna Hisenberg, who was married to Frank Lloyd Wright. The Russians, it has been claimed, are using a giant Tesla magnifying transmitter to modify the world's weather, creating extremes of ice and drought. In 1935, the New York American blasted the famous explorer F.A. Mitchell Hedges because he had written, "Atlantis existed. Its engulfment caused a flood, a cataclysm that wiped out millions. Hidden valleys that shelter a hard existence for a precious few, bald, sun-scorched mountains, nearly impractical roads washed out half the time by raging torrents, and yet a fascinating wild beauty bathed in extraordinary light." Photographs show Madame Blavatsky to have possessed strong arms, several chins, and slightly bulging eyes. In the Zagora, the last stop before the Gazelle country, there's a hotel with a swimming pool, bacteriologically pure and therefore theoretically fit to drink. At the end of August, we flew from Rome to London to see Leonardo's deluge drawings. Romanus realized that the hunt for heretics had to be intensified, but he was not very successful in devising new methods to find them. The sky is full, but it is not. Then the devil went to the gate of paradise, wanting to enter, and could not. He remained at the gate 1,000 years. Plumes of the white egret were used to make ceremonial wands and military insignias. He claimed to have been wounded in Tibet in 1902, while on a mission there to study occult lore. The painting made the first leg of its journey from Venice to Baghdad by boat, wrapped in velvet and waterproof canvas, its existence incontrovertible proof that likeness could be attained. The true vegetable elixir has a pseudo-alchemical name, returned cinnabar with a wrinkled face. I never washed my coat and really took it off. In a matter of hours, maybe days, perhaps weeks, but certainly not years, it will rise above my windows. I'll just read two more. All right, it's going completely opposite directions, so why not read them? This one I don't even remember writing, but that's often the case. I just found it today on my computer, called Future Tales. Maybe one of you wrote it, I don't know. What association do you belong to? I'm a member of the Missing Companion Society. I used to live in Egypt before it turned its facade of falcons toward the Mediterranean. Oxygen is one of our lost appendages, an unpunctuated pocket sewn on the insides of shirts and blouses, a place we can't reach without effort. Afternoon slips off the plum shelf. A solemn occasion, we gather in the pantry and draw straws, but none of them fit. We leave the chimney behind, but drag its shadow across what we think is a good example of snow. Blue cellophane tape proves inefficient, a stumbling block to our nomadic impulses. My friend who repairs elevators tells me he saw 4 flying saucers about the 2nd of this month flying over his garage, but that he has not seen them since, and for some reason he can no longer remember, forgot to tell me at the time. Now, what becomes of these saucers in the winter when they cannot enter another country and they must abide here or perish? My friend asks in all seriousness. The scenery hasn't changed much since the author was told that many subscribers are calling in sick. The palms in front of the library periodically ignite, nearby clouds vibrate, white dust collects under our fingernails and in our hair. Time can change its face, but the oxen remain dazed and may never recover. The observatory is a tooth embedded in a scarlet parking lot. On the 4th day of our mythic journey, we stop and erect tents in the field behind the Metropolitan Opera House. We're a diversion, and the dogs and bees know it. Gulp. This is the last poem. This was going to be the title, or maybe the title poem of my book. I'm not sure. I keep going back and forth. So it's called English, and it has a little line before it: "You need to speak Singlish to express a Singaporean feeling," by Catherine Liu. "I never learned Singlish. I cannot speak Taglish, but I've registered the tonal shifts of Dumblish, Bunglish, and Scumglish. I do not know English, but I will study it down to its black and broken bones. I do not know English, but I speak dung and dungarees, satray and claptrap. Today I speak barbecue and canoe. Today I speak running dog and yellow dog. I do not know spin gloss, but I hear humdrum and humdinger, bugaboo and jigaboo. I do not know Anguish, but I can tell you that my last name consists of three letters, and technically all of them are vowels. I do not know Umglish, but I do know how to eat with two sticks. Oh, but I do know English because my father's mother was English, and because my father was born in New York in 1921 and was able to return to America in 1949 and become a citizen. I know speak Chinese, Chanel, or Cheyenne. I do not speak or dream in Chinese because my parents were afraid I would never learn to speak English properly. They were afraid I would mumble in English. I do know English because I'm able to tell others that I am not who they think I am. I do not know Chinese because my mother said that I refused to learn it from the moment that I was born, and that my refusal was one of the greatest sorrows of her life, the other being the birth of my brother. I do know Chinese because I understood what my mother's friend told her one Sunday morning shortly after she sat down. I hope you don't mind that I parked my helicopter on your roof. Because I do not know Chinese, I've been told that this means I'm not Chinese by a man who translates from Spanish. He said that he had studied Chinese and was therefore closer to being Chinese than I could ever be. No one publicly disagreed with him, which according to the rules of English means he's right. I do know English, and I know that knowing it means that I don't always believe it. The fact that I disagree with a man who translates from the Spanish is further proof that I'm not Chinese, because all the Chinese living in America are hardworking and earnest and would never waste their time disagreeing with someone who is right. This proves I even know how to behave in English. It has been said by an authority on poetry that I don't look or act Chinese. I do know English because I understood what my first wife's mother meant when she said that people from India and Pakistan like to work at gas stations at night because they didn't have to worry about getting sunburned. I do know English because I got divorced, and therefore I must have misunderstood the vows I made at City Hall. I do know English because the second time I made a marriage vow, I had to repeat it in Hebrew. I do know English because I know what fortune cookie means when it's said of a Chinese woman. I do know English because I can read the book of names, which a friend has said can help me name my daughter. The authority on poetry announced that I discovered I was Chinese when it was to my advantage to do so. My father was afraid that if I did not speak English properly, I would be condemned to work as a waiter in a Chinese restaurant. My mother, however, said that this was impossible because I didn't speak Cantonese, because the only language waiters in Chinese restaurants knew how to speak was Cantonese. I do not know either Cantonese or English, Anglish or English. Anguish is a language everyone can speak, but no one listens to it. I do know English because my father was proud that he was half English and half Chinese before interracial marriage was acceptable under the law. I do know English because my father's mother was Ivy Hillier. She was born and died in Liverpool after living in America and China and claimed to be a descendant of the Huguenots. I do know English because I misheard my grandmother and thought that she said that I was a descendant of the Argonauts. I do know English because I remember what made in Japan meant when I was a child. I learned over and over again that I do not know Chinese. Yesterday a man asked me how to write my last name in Chinese because he was sure that I had been mispronouncing it, and that if this was how my father pronounced it, then the poor man had been wrong all his life. I do not know Chinese even though my parents conversed in it every day. I do know English because I had to ask the nurses not to put my mother in a straitjacket and reassure them that I'd be willing to stay with her until the doctor came the next morning. I do know English because I left the room when the doctor told me I had no business being there. I do not know Chinese because during the Vietnam War I was called a gook instead of a chink and realized that I had managed to change my spots without meaning to. I do not know English because when my father said he'd like to see me dead, I was never sure quite what he meant. I do not know Chinese because I never slept with a woman whose vagina slanted like my mother's eyes. I do not know either English or Chinese, and because of that, I did not put a gravestone at the head of my parents' graves, as I felt no language mirrored the ones they spoke. Thanks. Thanks. Oops.
Just maybe sit here for a second, and then if you want to get a position.
Thank you.
I have a question about being a poet and also being in the academy, because I think sometimes they do not really, they don't really converge very well.
So right.
Because at Queen's College we have Nico Han, and we also have Nicole Cooley, who are poets anymore. And I actually, at Queen's College, I'm tutoring for English 140, which is poetry, and sometimes I feel like people don't even know the difference between prose and poetry, so
right.
They're in a different position.
Well, I think I'm probably contributed to the erosion of the difference between poetry and prose, because I kind of write in different forms, and I've sort of probably been influenced by reading a lot of European writers are writing in different forms where they don't seem so caught up as to whether it's poem or prose or, what's Francis Ponge's writings? To me, it's just writing at this point. I don't actually teach I teach in art schools. I'm not generally hired to teach in English departments. And I've never tried to work in an English department. I did teach in the English department at Berkeley for one semester in 94, 95. But I sort of didn't want to be in English departments when I got out of college. And I thought I could survive as a freelance writer, which I sort of did, but probably not as well as if I'd gotten a job teaching. But I sort of didn't mind. It was until I got older, got married, and had a child, and then thought I better do something about that. I think it is hard. I think it works, but I'll just say this. Meena can bop me over the head if she disagrees. Art schools or art departments tend to be more radical than many English departments, in the sense that practicing poets are more disvalued, I think, than practicing artists, or undervalued, which I think is really, English departments that I've taught in some, I think the only poets they like are the ones that are dead, because then it's all decided whether that poet is good or not. You meet lots of people who teach in English departments. It's a generalization, but lots of them don't read a lot of contemporary poetry. And I just find that a little disturbing.
I don't think that's the most disturbing point that I find, is not that whether they read contemporary or dead, but whether they read poetry at
all. Oh, right. Yeah.
And I think the point I was trying to make with the English 140 is that's the only class actually I took in poetry, except I didn't take the 17th century poetry course, but that was like a method. that students don't really have to take poetry. It's more of an emphasis on the novel.
Right, right. Right.
I have a question. In terms of writing poetry as a creative process, and what goes through your mind when you begin to write, at least for both of you, when you write, does it just come out? Can you describe some of that creative process as a piece of work is being formed?
I'll let you go.
I was still brooding on this comment by Don about poets in English departments, and
I knew that would get you.
Right, nothing to bop you with, right?
Here.
Right. I tell my graduate students, I have a day job. Why shouldn't I teach, right? I could wait, but I'd probably drop the dishes. Be a waitron, wait, you know. I don't know how to drive, so I couldn't be a driver. I think a poets sell insurance. Wallace Stevens, I suppose he did rather well, he climbed high.
He did, he became vice president.
Right, exactly. So, one can do all sorts of things, right? As opposed to the temper of an English department, that's a whole other question. It's a whole other thing. I think departments vary enormously. In some, yes, you have to be dead. But, in others, they like you to teach a little bit, so that's okay. creative, actually making work. I don't know where to start. I think, all I know is sometimes I go into a kind of daze, right? And then I know I'm starting to think something. And I'm kind of tuned out. And even my students are very kind. They now help me through. If I'm trying to teach, I'm trying to write a poem at the same time. It's kind of difficult. But I think that, I think of, at least for me, of making a poem is really, it's like a kind of internal voice. And it keeps going, and then you have to do something about it, because otherwise, you would just jump off a bridge or something, right? And then that voice needs form, and sometimes for me, writing a poem, it doesn't sometimes have words, it's more like a rhythm. And I'll go for a walk, and then I have an image, and then something with a certain kind of music starts to happen. So in that way, I sort of agree with what you said, John, about poetry and prose, because I think it's highly charged language, and I'm not that interested in what the line is. I'm not sure there is a line between one and the other. Sometimes I read a page out of my memoir in person, someone says, well, read the poem again, and I say, well, it isn't a poem, but then who cares? I think that language does its own strange magic, strange corrosions, I think, of the kinds of forms we take for granted. So I think that there's something, for me, there's always something a little bit unexpected about coming to poetry, but it's also absolutely inevitable, at least insofar as I think of myself as I am. I remember ages ago when I was very young and I thought, well, I wanted to be a poet, so I went to see a friend, wonderful Indian poet called Jayanta Mahapatra in Katak, which is in Orissa, with extraordinary sculptures and so on. So Jayanta said to me, well, Meena, the thing is that you have to have the guts to sit in front of a blank piece of paper. And I thought, what the hell are you talking about? But then I kind of understand it now. It's very hard. It's maybe as hard as learning how to drive a car in America or something. It's just damnably hard. So, one little story about writing. When my daughter was 4, we were in the elevator, and she said to me, Mom, why do you talk to yourself all the time? The other mothers don't do it. And that was when I realized that, when I write poetry, I talk, and then I stop because I thought my children are going to go crazy. They'll think this is, something awful is going to happen. So then I stopped it, and I went out to sit in a, like a coffee bar, and then I would talk to myself, and they think, oh, she's a strange bag lady with her papers, But, I try not to do it in front of my children, but it's like,
I just talk silly talk to my child. Says, you're silly, why don't you talk differently to me? I don't know where. I write a lot of art essays, and then sort of in the midst of that, often I get some notion or idea of a poem. A lot of them are conceptual in a way, like I knew that I wanted to write poems based on stretching out movie plots, and I thought of it as how long could I make a line continue before it fell apart completely. And I thought of the line as like a camera putting together different movie scenes. So that was conceptual, and then I decided once I wrote one that I had to write more than one. And then it sort of led from one thing to another, and then other things came about. I did research on, or I've been doing research on movie actors, white movie actors who play Asians. So I wrote about Boris Karloff. I'm now doing a lot of research on Bela Lugosi, because, you know, and I try to find out, I literally try to get all their DVDs and videos and watch them. I have books. I have a book that reports to be, have a plot summary of every Charlie Chan movie ever made that's still in existence, with samples of their dialogue. So I do a lot of research on different subjects. I bought the only two truly, there were two bad biographies of Boris Karloff, and I slogged my way through them. I have lots of books about Bela Lugosi. And I'm slogging my way. I mean, they're really bad. Badly written, badly edited, bad spelling. But I don't care. I mean, I just want the information. So that's one whole project, you know, kind of researching Hollywood, Peter Lorre, others. And then others, I mean, I always felt like I didn't want to write about my family, and then I had to figure out ways I could do it. And that took a long time, and now I'm doing it. Me, because I'm older and I have a daughter. I also feel like whenever I say I don't want to do something, that I always feel like this is a psychoanalytic moment. Like anything I don't want to do, I have to question it and then therefore do it. That's probably the result of 14 years of therapy, right? It's got to do something for you.
You know, Joe, this thing about doing research for something, it's so interesting to me how one does it as a poet as opposed to another kind of mind, right? Mindset. Because I'm often very moved by works of visual art, which I know you have this thing also, you know, you write on art. And the Byzantium exhibit, for instance, which is there now, I mean, I keep going back to it. Andrea and I went to it, and I've been back several times. And part of it is that, you know, I grew up in the Orthodox Church in Kerala. I mean, I was brought up with these icons. But the connection between Byzantium and the Nubian Church, and I grew up in Sudan, in Khartoum, and I saw some of these frescoes being raised up after the Aswan High Dam was built. And Macedonia, where I'm going to go at the end of August for the poetry festival, some of those icons are from Ohrid. And for me, there is something in the patterning of those faces. And then if you look at some of the icons at the back, they look so much like a certain kind of Indian art. Right. Even some of Tagore's own drawings, you know. And I think, well, what is it in the shape of a face and of a dark face that it travels? And this fascinates me. So now I'm starting to read. I'm starting to read about St. Catherine's Monastery, Sinai in Egypt. And look at some of the icons, the ancient icons in the church, in the Jacobite church, you know, in Kerala, where I grew up. And think about what Byzantium was. And then I'm also reading my Yeats again, because, you know, sailing to Byzantium. So I think that, you know, I think for a poet, these connections that we make are in some way much more pliable and plastic, perhaps, than the kinds of writing that you have to do with footnotes, which I've also done. I've written more than one or two books on critical issues. So I think that there's something in the way the mind moves with feeling, through the places that you can accumulate and garner through the use of the intellect, that there's something special about that kind of searching, you know? I guess that's what I wanted to say.
Yeah, no, I spent, or I'm still in, spent months looking up how to, you know, stuff on Boris Karloff and finding it in the most, you know, published by little, you could tell there's probably three weird guys in a little building in Baltimore who run this press
about kind of bad grade B actors, among them Boris Karloff. And I just got fascinated with this whole weird subculture, so that at one point I was hanging around with people who went to movie memorabilia shows, because I was collecting every cigarette card I could on Anna Wong. And I was trying to collect a lot of information on her. And I went with these three people, two men and a woman, to these film memorabilia shows, and I knew that I'd really left whatever scene I was in and entered another one when the woman said, "Have you ever written anything?" I said, "Oh, I've written a few books, yeah." And she said, "What have you written?" And I couldn't think of what to say that, you know, would communicate anything to her. So I said, "Oh, I've written a book on Andy Warhol." And she kind of walked on, and then she said, "He made some movies, didn't he?" That was her only comment. I went, "Wow, wow, I've entered a world that, like, forget it. Whatever else I told him would be of no interest. I mean, I would have been speaking another language. I mean, it was." And I kind of wanted to find out about this world, and we went to really weird places, and you could find these, there's some places up in Herald Square where you go into a building and you go into a room and this guy has hundreds and hundreds of filing cabinets and you say Anna Wong and he goes over and opens a drawer and pulls out stuff. I mean, I saw a poster of a movie for $3,000, you know what I mean? It was a kind of weird world, but I wanted to find out everything I could at every level. And I would spend weeks where you don't know what the goal is, right? You just know it's like research for the love of the pure love of it, and you don't know, you can't, in a capitalist society, you're supposed to take A and convert it into B, right? And you're supposed to do it as economically and efficiently as possible. And if you do it really well, you're considered, you know, a business genius. And I think a poet is like, clearly, it's like whatever you're getting, you don't even know how it's gonna, you don't even know what B is, except you hope it's something written, right? And you just gather. So I've also had, you know, all this information where I don't know how it's gonna add up. I mean, I've been researching Bela Lugosi for off and on for a year and a half, and I've never written one thing about Bela Lugosi that I'm satisfied with, you know, so. And it was the same with Boris Karloff. I think I did research for 2 years before I really wrote. I ended up so absorbed that I was practically, I mean, like my child loves How the Grinch Stole Christmas, which of course the voice is Boris Karloff. Mm-hmm. And yesterday, a moment of pure paranoia, because I've written a poem which I was sure that I quote, I had a reference to every film Boris Karloff was in. And a moment of pure paranoia, I said to my wife, Eve, "I think I left out the Grinch movie." And he said, "No, I'm sure you put it in, because I think she didn't want to see me go crazy, you know." But there it was, listening, you know, I mean, that's a Dr. Seuss movie. And somehow I thought, why didn't I put that in? And I have to go look at my own poem to see if I have a reference now.
I think that you mentioned something about, you know, your teaching English in an arts department would be very different from...
Well, I don't teach English, I teach art history.
And it seems like one works with visual, with objects almost, and that's almost like reflexive what you are doing. And I think that the kind of things that Meena is doing, you know, going to different places and different images comes out. Maybe the creative process is the same. Maybe that it's, you know, see how that answers back to something deep inside you.
Oh, sure.
I think. And also I think that, you know, you have to go when something calls you and you really don't know why. I mean, like, I wrote that cycle about of poems about September 11th, 2001 when I was here, and then I knew that I had to be in Gujarat a year later at that time. So I think that there's a weird way in which temporality works through us. I mean, things happen in our internal time that we have very little verbal sense of. In other words, we have to do it, we have to go there, whatever the there is. And then something happens, and then maybe you make the poem if you're lucky. But I think there's all this not knowing which you have to go with.
Also, people or writers believe in a culture of language, but we live in a world where language is being kind of retreating, right? I mean, I heard this amazing story yesterday. This couple, one's a Marxist art historian, and his wife's an art historian, actually teaches an honor. And they went to the gym to do their exercises, which I was completely abused by. And then they said that there were these four people who work for magazines. They go to a gym where like lots of magazine people go. And four people were talking about their day, and they just talked about it in a way that only referenced television. Like, and one of the lines was, and so someone said, you know, what was my day like? And I said, huh? And that was it. That was the full description of that person's day, right? There was no language used. It was all gesture and kind of coded things that would reference television. And then these two art historians, I could see they were really bummed, just kept saying, language is retreating faster than we think, you know? And I was like, two poets at this dinner and four art historians and a photography critic. We're probably all ready to jump out the window after that dinner. But I think it's true, and I think that's, and I, you know, written language as a culture, at least in the West, is relatively short, you know, it's only like a few hundred years, right? There's a visual culture before, and it's sort of like the revenge of visual culture on written language is now extreme. It's like peeved that it got thrown aside for a couple hundred years.
But you know, also television, I mean, what does that do to the sort of flattening out of things that we see? I mean, there's a whole way of looking at television which is kind of different from when you go look at a painting or a piece of sculpture.
Oh, yeah.
It's very different.
Right? I mean, there's 123 channels and, you know, I mean,
and it's quick.
You know, and Google, which has no hierarchy, it's just a pure database. So
what do you think of that in terms of, say, does it offer more freedom in terms of, say, whatever expressions, whatever interests?
You know, I was just sitting in, before coming, I was sitting in Bryant Park, I told you, with this friend from Italy who was just visiting. She's actually an American who's lived in Parma for about 25 years. So we were talking and we were talking precisely about this, about the internet and the political culture now, you know, in this country and the strange moment we're in politically. And she was saying, you know, I don't know what's going to happen to us. Maybe there's going to be a kind of totalitarianism. And she started talking about the internet, and I said, what do you mean? And she said, I think we're bombarded with so much, we really don't know anymore. And people don't know what to say, because to say something, nobody listens. And then I started talking about aphasia, because I think that in this culture, we have a very, very short-term memory, and we forget. Emerson had this extraordinary essay where he said, you know, we're Americans, we have no need of memory, and he thought of memory as a European thing.
Yeah.
But, you know, I really think we live that way. I think we live without memory in some way, and we need to do that. I mean, need meaning the way things are constructed. And I think the market, I don't even know anything about how stock markets work, but I know they go like this, right? People say, oh, don't make the market nervous, as if it were a person or a beast or something, because it's going to get nervous. I mean, what is this thing, right? I mean, so I think that, you know, there is something spiky and jagged and very, very hard to formulate aesthetically. You know, I think if you look at ancient cultures, I mean, I was thinking about India or China, I mean, there's certain forms that are still out there in public space, which are very, very old, and people acknowledge them, live by them, but they're there.